Those of you who looked at the program earlier might be a little surprised that although, you know, I'm obviously not Robert Watson, even though I do have a beard, but that's where the similarity pretty much ends. So Robert couldn't make it and asked if I would give a keynote here, so they kind of sent me along as the surrogate band. I'm actually speaking to Robert's suggestion. He wanted to get a little idea of how open source and the real world, or the commercial world, interact. I shouldn't say real world because it's anything but real. I'm going to use SendMail as a case study, not necessarily because it's the very best example, but it's obviously the example I know best. So I'll try and make some general commentary where possible, but I am going to, you know, this is all my own personal opinion. And I'm going to talk a lot about open source companies here. I want to emphasize that I'm not talking about companies that use open source. Just because, you know, you run Apache does not mean that you're an open source company. I'm talking about companies that actually produce and distribute open source on one level or another. One important thing, how many people understand the Bambi meets Godzilla reference? Who doesn't? Probably lots of people don't. Okay. I actually, it's a short video, came out years ago. I have a copy of it. It's only a couple minutes, and at the end of my talk, I'll run it so you folks can understand. But suffice it to say, it doesn't end well for Bambi. Now, as I said, I got this kind of at the last moment. In fact, just about a week ago, this is where I was, in the middle of Kruger National Park in South Africa. So please be gentle with me. This is a talk I've never given before, and I was kind of literally throwing it together while on safari. So a little bit about my background. I'm a longtime open source developer. I started somewhere around 1975, maybe 74. I was 3 years old at the time. I worked on the Ingres relational database management system before there were relational database management systems, so I kind of got my start in research. Although I have worked in academia, research, commercial, you know, I've sort of done it all at one time or another. I wrote Syslog. Not a lot of people seem to know that, and it's probably my most important work, more so than SendMail, frankly. And I wrote some TROF macros that are, believe it or not, still in use today by some people. I wrote a game called Trek, which was a text-based game, but it was very popular for a while, and I still get email from people sometimes saying, you know, I'm having trouble compiling it, can you help me? The reason it's hard to compile is because the last time I compiled it was on Unix 6th edition. Obviously, oh, I wrote a bunch of other BSD utilities. SendMail's obvious. You all know that. I have actually dabbled in the kernel. I wrote a 9-track tape driver and a punched card reader tape or driver. But I'm not a kernel guy. I don't even come close. If you want to talk about kernel stuff, come to Kirk's keynote at the closing, because he'll talk about the kernel. And I started SendMail Inc. in 1998, which is one of the first hybrid commercial open source companies. It was really kind of greenfield. We didn't really know what we were doing. We made a lot of mistakes, but we got a lot of stuff right. We did at least enough right to survive the tech crash in 2001. But suffice it to say that along with laws and sausages, one of the things you really don't want to see being made are companies. And I'm going to talk a little bit about that. As of last month, actually, I'm officially now retired from SendMail. I was working part-time for a while, but I do remain on good terms with them. It's not like, you know, I got summarily marched out the door or anything. And hopefully, after I give this talk, I'll still be on good terms with them. So I see that it's being filmed, so I have to be careful what I say here. So SendMail started off, SendMail the code started off as one of the very early open source projects. I said here it's part of BSD. Actually, it didn't start as part of BSD. It started because we had a problem in the Ingres project, which was basically a system administration problem having to do with what turned out to be email, even though we didn't know it at first. And so it was I built it for that. But like most open source of the era, it went through a bunch of growth spurts. It didn't take very long before we realized that there were a bunch of systems on campus that needed this thing, so it got generalized to a small extent. And then it got incorporated into BSD, and it had to be generalized again because not the whole universe looked exactly like Berkeley, and then the internet explosion came along, and then it was tons and tons of hosts, and you know, had to go through even more generalization, and also the world was changing, of course. Believe it or not, when SendMail was first written, the internet didn't exist yet. So it was originally written for the ARPANET. It's remained community supported through that whole process. Usually, you know, I was doing it on my own for a while, but then, you know, got a small community of people. I kind of used the benevolent dictator model with trusted lieutenants, which is the same thing that the Linux kernel uses. The problem, of course, was that the internet did explode, and even doing the support with a bunch of volunteers, this scaling just collapsed. I'd gotten to the point where I couldn't do any coding anymore because I spent all of my time doing support. Support is hard, it's tedious, and it's never ending. It just keeps on going forever and ever and ever and ever. The whole thing had turned into a success disaster. Now, some projects use the read the find manual approach, which it can also be translated as, you're on your own, don't call us. But that only works with dedicated audiences that are willing to dig through all of this stuff. And of course, there has to be a fine manual to read before you can read the fine manual, which is not a given by any means. So I'm gonna make my first controversial, I hope it's controversial, assertion that all successful large open source projects have to get money in at some point because they have to in order to get beyond this problem. If you work on the community organization model, it limits how far you can go. So I really wanted to get back to coding again. I was still doing this nights and weekends. I'd never been officially, mind you, paid to do it. So I thought about doing, you know, tried to get companies to fund me to do this, kind of the foundation model, didn't work. And there's a story behind that too. And I ended up starting a company. It turns out sometimes it's easier to ask for $1 million than $1,000. So remember, all I wanted was a support department. So there's a bunch of models you can do to get money into such things. One of them that really didn't exist back then but is pretty common now is to start a foundation. And you get donations either from individuals or companies. Mozilla's done this, Eclipse has done this, Apache has done this, FreeBSD has done this. It's a really common thing to do. Another option is, of course, to find an angel who will shower you with money. I don't have friends rich enough to do that. I think some people do, but it helps to have a family member, actually. You can sell yourself to someone with deep pockets, which has been done several times. Remember, though, when you sell yourself, once you are sold, you have no leverage anymore, especially if you're the only asset to speak of. And they may not have your best interests in mind. In fact, it's not that uncommon for a company to buy up something smaller, be it open source or commercial, just to shut it down. And you can start your own company, which is what I did. It's what Red Hat did. So, I further assert that open source actually needs commercial input. It's not just an evil thing. It's a fairly rare case, even though open source started off where the developers were in fact the customers, i.e. we were writing things to solve our own problem. That's increasingly rare. Although there's still software-based research where software is either the point of the research or necessary for the research, where that remains true. But in fact, as we've seen numerous times, developer design consumer software usually varies on the spectrum somewhere between unimpressive and completely unusably awful. Developers just don't think, I mean, good developers, I should say, don't think like what I'll call for the moment normal human beings. We think logically, we think, you know, orthogonally and that sort of thing. The world is not orthogonal, sorry to break it to you. This, by the way, is one thing that a really good product manager, which is normally a marketing role, can do for you. The great product managers have some development background, but they're really rooted in marketing and the customer and so forth, and they're good at translating. Good ones translate as opposed to demand. Other examples are things that developers would normally think of as soft items, like, you know, documentation and that sort of thing. Frontline support is an obvious one. Most developers have no tolerance for doing the frontline support. I have done it. I did it actually for a number of years. It was painful. Now, please don't take away from this that I think that good developers aren't loners, you know, not the sort who, you know, go into a dark room and lock the door and you throw raw meat in. Good developers actually communicate like mad, but they don't tend to speak the same language as the folks outside this room. So, 2 points here, markets and models. Commercial markets for open source comes down to, all right, who's going to pay for this? Okay, the folks who just want to get it for free are probably not your target market. People, believe it or not, have tried that, but that was in the old pre-bubble burst days where if you got enough eyeballs, you'd figure out how to make money off of them someday. But that didn't work really well. Businesses, are they your target market? Well, what do you mean by business? I mean, a small business is not a medium-sized business, is not a big international enterprise, it's not a carrier grade kind of level. If you're doing network stuff, you have to think about carrier grade. And the other thing is businesses don't really buy code, or at least what they're paying for is partially code, but mostly it's trust. It's you build up a relationship with them on some level. It's a lot more than just code. Consumers are very, very fickle. You change the color of the icon and it will go from being bitching cool to being last year's stuff overnight. And so you constantly have to be keeping up with them. They need a really polished product. It's very, very hard to work in the consumer industry beyond a certain size. You can always do small stuff, of course. Most customers, by the way, don't care that you have really cool technology, and they especially don't care that you're open source. They don't buy source code unless they're developers, because most of them, dare I say, if it's written in C, it might as well be written in Polish. Polish on the code, true. The point is, they're buying a solution to their problem. They're not buying code, they're not buying technology. Really cool technology is not a market maker. Other thing to point out is that open source tends to commoditize a market. Sendmail started off we basically were targeting the anyone who runs an MTA market. That turns out to have been a really bad market. We have kept kind of to the original design, except that we found that our sweet spot was large enterprises, because they pay for a whole different kind of thing than anyone who runs an MTA. Companies like OpenWave, when Sendmail started up, were selling great big, very expensive mail systems, of which the key component was the MTA. They have now moved on to something completely different. You can't make money selling just an MTA anymore because MTAs are a dime a dozen. There's you know, 20, 30 out of them in common use that are really pretty good. Sendmail being one of them, but by no means exclusively. So that forces suppliers to move up the food chain. So that was markets. Let's talk about models. One model for an open source company is that you continue to just give away the code and you sell something else. Common things are support, services, which is customization and that sort of thing, which costs more than vanilla support. Documentation, stability perhaps. I don't mean stability of the code. I mean customer confidence in the stability. They want to have somebody they can pick up the phone and call. They want somebody they can sue if absolutely necessary. It does not speak to the code at all. Second is, it stays free, but you sell bundles. This is common for some distributions, and notably appliances, where you are paying for the hardware, but vast majority of what you're doing is paying for the open source software that has been pre-installed, pre-configured, push-button install. You're paying for ease of use, effectively. Another one is free basic technology, open source, and so forth, but then you have commercial non-open source add-ons. And that's actually pretty common. You can build an entire ecosystem out of this. It generally supersets the first bullet item because you still need support and services and documentation and all that stuff. And of course, there's the famous approach which has been tried called the technology grab. You basically say, okay, the open source is dead now, and if you want it, you buy from us. Historically, that hasn't worked very well, and I'm not going to talk any more about it. So let's talk about starting a company, assuming you want to go that route. First thing you need to know is starting a company is not about technology. It may be to you, but it's not to everyone else. It is about things like finance, which starts with investors and moves on from there. It's about sales, of course. It's about marketing. One definition of marketing is it makes the product easy to buy. So it's, in fact, very closely connected with sales on some level. It's about support. Remember, that's the one I wanted. It's about services, customizing and extending and so forth. And oh, by the way, incidentally, we do need an engineering department because I guess we ought to have a product to sell. But that's kind of an afterthought, actually. I didn't know what most of those functions did when I started up. I thought I did, but I didn't. And now I do, or at least I know more than I did. Pity me. There's another thing to note here. Finance is clearly about money. Sales, it's about money. It's revenue stream. Marketing supports sales, so it's about money. Support, you know, people pay for that. It's a profit center, you know? So it's about money. Service is definitely a profit center, no doubt about it. And engineering, oh, whoops, that's a cost center. Businessmen think totally different about cost centers than they do about profit centers. Trust me on this one. So there's this deep tension between open source and commercial needs. Open source tends to be more engineering focused. It's about building things, it's about sharing them, it's about having the flexibility to change them if you don't like the way it works, make the world a better place, give it back, solve interesting problems, professional development, maybe if you're lucky you'll become famous, all of these sorts of things. Commercial is much simpler. It's about making money. Sales guys do not understand how to make money when you're giving away the product. This just goes completely against everything they've ever learned. I have been accused multiple times of being a communist, not as a joke. I am not now and never have been a member of the Communist Party, just so you know. There's an immense pressure toward coming up with either new products or feature creep in order to keep a revenue stream going, because after all, if everyone buys your product and it just works and keeps working forever, you're going to run out of revenue pretty soon. So the idea is that you constantly keep coming up with new stuff. You know, Quicken is a great example of this. Every time Quicken comes out, there's a whole pile of new features that I don't want. iTunes, frankly, started off as a great program. Now it's pretty bad. Apple is not going the direction I would like them to go. Feature creep, by the way, it can be loosely defined as doing more and more, less and less well. And the other thing to realize is that money is the lifeblood of companies. You miss payroll even once, you're dead. I mean, it's over. So they're very, very focused on money. And there's nothing inherently wrong about that. Now, there are ways to justify open source to companies, even when you're a communist. The common one is to say, well, it leverages other people's work. It speeds development and so forth. Remember, engineering is a cost center, so if we can reduce engineering costs, that's good for the bottom line. Licenses can be showstoppers here, but this isn't a talk about licenses. I felt that it was important to point it out. Can be useful as a recruiting incentive. It's hard to get good engineers, especially in certain parts of the world, and sometimes open source is a way to tempt them in. Now, that can have an unanticipated result. It may not be unanticipated for us, but it's unanticipated for the rest of the company in that it can cause a culture shift, for the better, in my opinion, not so for other departments. One thing people don't think about too much is disrupting the market. If you can commoditize something that is the underlying source of profit for your competitors, then it's good for you. That's a little tricky to do because you don't want to also, you know, cut yourself off at the knees, but it's a good thing. And it can make customers more comfortable. Even if they are not technologists, the concept that you are not going to just withdraw a product at some point and leave them hanging in the breeze can make some customers feel better, particularly once you get above a certain level. So I mentioned culture. Let's talk a little bit about that. The big question to a first approximation is your company going to be engineering driven or sales and marketing driven? Almost no really large company is in fact engineering driven, at least beyond a certain point. Google is kind of an exception, and it's an anomaly. They did a lot of very tricky things with multiple classes of voting rights on stock and so forth to make that popular. That's the finance part, which I really don't want to talk about if I can avoid it. Investors do prefer sales and marketing driven because investors are there for the money as well, and they understand that a lot better. And the investors run the board, which isn't strictly true. It's the stockholders that run the board, but since the investors are almost always the board, the investors are almost always the stockholders. Google and Facebook, by the way, are again counterexamples, but again because of finance tricks. Pure sales and marketing driven companies, however, can be very, very weird. And you really kind of want to avoid that if possible. Now, what Sendmail did, and this was, I think, a mistake, was we said, you know, if you have to ask the question, is it marketing, sales, or engineering driven, then you've asked the wrong question. Because obviously we all have to work together, which I still believe is obviously true. But it turns out if you don't ask the question, then things tend to drift toward being more sales and marketing driven. Sales will always win in a fiscal crisis because remember, if you, you know, miss payroll, you bleed to death and you're gone, and companies like to survive just as much as we do. And a fiscal crisis always comes along sooner or later. Now, like everything else I've said in here, there are exceptions. If you're sitting on billions of dollars in cash, you can probably weather a few fiscal crises without too much concern. You know, Apple can do that, Google can do that. But, you know, I personally, I can assure you Sendmail Inc. is not sitting on $2 billion in cash in the bank. It's just not happening. So note about foundations. At this point, I'm sure I've convinced you all that the only right way to do it is to go to a foundation. Foundations do insulate you from the day-to-day pressures. Foundations don't have to think quarter to quarter, which companies do. There's a very short-term focus on quarterly results. Foundations do not, in fact, completely insulate you. If your major funder comes along and says, I'm yanking your funding next year unless you do X, well, you're probably going to do X, or you have to find other donors. And the other thing about foundations is, believe it or not, you do get good things from companies. A really good marketing department can add a lot of value to engineering as well as to sales. The bad ones, not so much. And I've worked at places with good marketing departments and bad marketing departments, and it's a world of difference. So I want to talk a little bit about some lifecycle issues. I'm going to sort of show you an open source project, a research project, an open, non-military, non-proprietary kind of research project, like you might get at a university, and a company. I'm going to break these up into a series of phases, and there are some interesting similarities, and there are also some interesting differences. So let me start off with the initial inspiration. With open source, the traditional one is scratch and itch. Gee, I have a problem that I would like to solve, and hey, I know how to code, so I'll just do that. Research projects asks a question, which is, has a certain similarity. Companies start by seeing revenue opportunities. They do care about the question or the problem or whatever, but only to the extent that they see it as a way to get money out of it. And by the way, so when I make these sweeping generalizations, like all generalizations, they are wrong, including that one. So next step is making it possible. So, you've now got this idea, this light bulb over your head. Now what do you do? With open source, you start off by seeing if it's been done before. Well, that's actually an optional step. A lot of people do stuff that's already been done before, sometimes better and often not. You should do an architectural design. That's another one that gets skipped pretty often, and we've all worked with software where there was obviously no thought given to how it was all going to fit together. Choose your languages and tools. Start writing code. Now, you start writing code really, really early in the open source models, which is one of the things that's great about it and also one of the things that gets it into a lot of trouble. Research project is kind of similar. You start by researching the literature to find out what's already been done out there. The concept that you want to not redo somebody else's research, although validating somebody else's research is legitimate. You get a grant, because you do need some kind of funding typically to pay the researchers, and you line up your grad students. With a company, you write a business plan. These vary from 100-page or 200-page, very detailed things to scribble out on the back of an envelope. The Sun's business plan was one page long, for example. Sendmail's business plan was 150 pages. Go figure. Line up investors, which basically means finding people who think that you have a chance of making money for them. That's a whole separate topic in itself. Investors are herd animals. I can talk about that offline if you're interested. Optional step, figure out the corporate culture. If you don't figure out a corporate culture, it will figure itself out and it may not be what you want. So I really do recommend that you spend some time thinking about it. And of course, hire a team. The corporate culture thing, by the way, will affect what kind of team you hire. Birthing the baby. Well, with open source, it's going to be the early, 0.x releases, getting stuff out there for people to start using, giving feedback, start building your community. With a research project, you start writing code or doing the actual research, whatever it is you need, and you start doing teasers. You might do little conference papers talking about what you're working on or whatever, so that people are kind of aware of what's going on. And so it's, again, pretty much a parallel to the building the community thing. With a company, you start building your product, which you'll notice comes fairly late compared to open source. Line up your early customers. Last thing you want to do is, hey, we've got this new product, and then have everyone start evaluating it. You want them to have been evaluating it as it goes. And that usually means starting trade shows and things so that you can get your name out there. Making it real. With open source, that's kind of defined as release 1.0. All right, here's the first one that's not in beta release. Some companies skip this entirely, and it's always in beta release, but it's sort of still release 1.0. You address the support problem. Seems like it's always true in open source projects that as soon as you've got something real out there, only then is when people go, oh, wait, I guess I have to support this. Thinking about it in advance seems to be a problem. And of course you've got documentation. Oh, documentation, forgot the documentation. So unfortunately documentation is usually an afterthought. It comes after release 1.0. There'll be some documentation in release 1.0. It just proves to be inadequate. Research project is simple. Publish or perish. That's what research is about. getting stuff out there. With a company, you get your first release out, and then you have to start scaling things like support and services. Support, you can actually staff up fairly late in the game unless your product is so complicated that it requires a year to master it, which hopefully it doesn't. Well, at that point, you want to start thinking about growing it. Open source, you don't have a community by now, you're done. Might as well go home. Assuming you do have a community and things are looking good, well, you better write the O'Reilly book. That seems to be an obligatory step. You want to avoid second systems effect. Once again, this one is, you all know what second systems effect is? No. Okay, Brooks talked about this in the Mythical Man Month. Second system effect is when people have written a system and it works, and you know, usually works pretty well, but it's not really complete yet. They come along going, okay, we're going to do the second system, release two, if you will. And they put in everything that they wanted to put into release one, but knew that they couldn't fit it all into that release. And so you end up with this huge monstrosity of things that don't quite work together. That's second system effect. And so you ultimately do release two or three or whatever you need to be doing the growth. With research project, by the way, these are on different time scales. So open source can be anything from, you know, 3 months to 3 years. You know, companies, similar spread. Research projects tend to be about 4 or 5 years. They tend to be about the length of one grad student period. So it's fairly artificial. So research project, growing it, you're not really growing it. You're actually kind of shutting it down. It's thesis time. Your slaves, the students, are graduating, and they're going off to other things. Occasionally, you'll add more grad students and keep a project going, but it's more common to sort of start over with a new set of students. Companies, you're getting a second release. The focus here is now pushing to profitability. So far, you've probably been burning money, but now you want to start having it come in. That almost inevitably runs to your first or maybe second round of layoffs and your second or third or fourth round of investment. So far it's been pretty expensive and got to get profitable somehow. And so what are the next steps? Well, with open source, you've got a lot of options. You might just throw it to the winds, say, okay, I'm done with that. It's out there. It's on SourceForge. Let people do what they want with it. They can support it if they want. Can hand it over to some larger organization, merge it in with something, whatever. You can commercialize it. You know, if what you really want to do with your nights and weekends is sit and write code, you may choose to just keep doing the same thing that you've been doing all along. There's nothing wrong with that. It does limit your ultimate growth, but there's nothing wrong with that either. Research project, next steps are to ask another question, which has usually been suggested. Research projects, if they're actually successful, tend to raise more questions than they answer. So there's always a new font of things to ask yourself about. Companies have kind of three outcomes at this step. You have a liquidity event, which is management babble for, you know, how you turn your theoretical money into real money. Liquidity events such as an IPO, and you continue. Now you've got a pile of cash and you're no longer a startup. You've got a liquidity event in the form of being acquired and you get assimilated into some other company. In some cases, you may keep your identity, and it's more common though that your identity kind of goes away and you just get absorbed into the Borg. And of course, the third and most common option is you go bankrupt and die. Now, I want to talk about another life cycle because it's relevant to this conference, and it's actually different from any of those three. It kind of straddles several of them, which is the life cycle of BSD. So this is, notice BSD is Berkeley Software Distribution, so it's not any distribution, it's this particular one. So step one, you discover fascinating new technology that's been written by a few people working kind of under the radar at some research lab on the other coast. And it mostly kind of works, and it's really cool, and it's fun. And you play with it, and you start to get frustrated by its limitations. You just think, boy, it's a really good concept, but boy, if it could only do this. And so you get into the phase where it's like, you start dreaming. Next step, you find a charismatic leader who can convince the already underpaid grad students to do even more work for free, often more work than they're doing on their degree progress in some cases, right, Kirk? that's, of course, Bill Joy. You share it, you evangelize it, and an important step is to convince the original creators that you get it. Okay, and you know you've achieved this when they start donating stuff back to you instead of putting it in their own release, because it's easier to get it out through you than it is through their own organization. Am I allowed to talk about symbolic links? most people don't realize, but symbolic links were not done at Berkeley. That was Dennis Ritchie, who found it easier to get into BSD than into their own distribution. Very, very important step, be in the right place at the right time. In Berkeley's case, it was when DARPA was adopting Unix as their preferred platform. I should have put this as a separate step because it is a separate step. Win the contract. And eventually do a nearly complete rewrite of the whole system. Next step, get sued by the original owner who has finally figured out that what they had might actually have value. For extra credit, you get them to believe that they wrote the stuff that you wrote, so they sue you for writing your own code. Eventually, the judge believes you and you win the court case. You spin off from the university because at some point you get to a point where it's really not appropriate as a university project anymore. It's almost quasi-commercial. Well, somehow, miraculously maintaining the kind of original principles of the system from years before, mostly. And then you have to set up sustainable models for running the various projects, which we've been pretty successful at. And very important, you award maturity rather than profligacy, because if you just award number of lines of code written, things will pretty much decay pretty quickly. Now, I want to point out two mistakes that founders make, two fairly classic mistakes. These are not quite mutually exclusive, although they go in different directions. One is that they assume they know everything. They have the vision, and if there are any antibodies that come into the I should say any viruses or whatever that come into the company that think that they have a better idea of the vision, they fight them and try and stem them off. It turns out that founders never know everything, although some are so convinced that they do, and they make other people's lives miserable and they get forced out. The usual length of time a founder survives at a company is, you know, a year or 2 years, sometimes three, very, very common story. The second mistake is assuming that everybody else is more knowledgeable than you, and this is more the direction that I went. Beware of people who tell you that their field is so arcane that you couldn't possibly understand what they're doing. By the way, this is the standard thing that bad marketing people will tell you. No. I would explain it to you if only your brain were bigger. Sometimes that is true. There are some obscure points on finance, for example, that even having looked at it time and time again, I just don't get this stuff. My mind does not work that way. Not very often. I started getting sort of marginalized at SendMail. I was very, very involved in all the day-to-day, all the decisions and so forth. And at some point, I started to realize that I was really getting on some people's nerves. This, in fact, happened when we went from a very good VP of marketing who loved engineers, believe it or not, and was, you know, when he found that I was actually interested in what he was doing, he wanted to explain everything because he thought it was so cool that this engineer actually cared, to somebody who was like, I'm very busy, I don't have time to answer your questions. And that should have been a big red flag for me, and I didn't realize it at the time. I just thought, all right, I'm getting too big for my britches. When people start making comments in meetings and you go, boy, that sounds like a really bad idea, but you know, they know so much more about this than I do, I'm not going to say anything. You know? Sometimes, in fact, most of the time, the stuff that doesn't make sense to you, in fact, is just fine. But a lot of the time, the stuff that doesn't make sense because it doesn't make sense. It's just crazy. And that's sort of my story of where I probably started to lose it there. Should have been more careful. Now, obviously, what you need is some kind of happy medium between the two. You don't want to be micromanaging very, very bad thing. So you have to trust some people and so forth. So a couple of conclusions. I think without a doubt that commercial input to open source has in fact permitted it to take on far larger problems than it would have been if it were just, you know, us working in our bedrooms or offices or whatever. Good marketing input really allows you to take on not just bigger things but a whole different class of problems. It's really very, very important. I am a complete, utter fan of marketing now, good marketing. When I started SendMail, I was not a big fan of marketing at all. But conversely, open source has lost its innocence. You know, it's way more about money now. You know, it takes money to run conferences like this. And that means you need sponsors and so forth and so on. Corporations emphasize survival, which means money, over technological beauty, elegance, etc. There's going to be a constant battle between doing the technologically right thing and doing the thing that keeps the company alive. It's just unpreventable. And there is actually a bonus third mistake that founders make, which I should tell you about. Is believing that they'll be able to get back to coding by starting a company. Thank you. So I think I have time for one or two questions, or I can run the video, your choice. Video, okay. You can still ask me questions, but it'll have to be afterwards. So there you have it. Thank you very much.